Hey everyone, Cursed Deck Builder here, making our way to 10,000 decks assisted, and right now we're looking at Nahiri, Forged in Fury, Go Wide Equipment. This deck comes to us from Erica, who says, I'm struggling to establish a board state fast enough to be relevant in my mid to high level pods. It's also difficult to find the right balance between creatures and equipment to allow Nahiri's ability to work to its full potential and still have creatures to attach things to. And in terms of restrictions, no Soul Ring or other quote-unquote fast mana, and only three non-land tutors allowed in the deck, which is quite a shame for equipment, but we'll talk about that later. As for the moment, we can absolutely work within that and see what we can do to help the deck. But quickly, some administrative stuff, as we often do at the start of a day. Just as a reminder, if you want to watch me play some Commander tomorrow on Wednesday, I will be on MTG Mudsta's stream. I still haven't found out exactly when we're starting. It would be probably around 6 or 7 EST, but I'm not too sure. Yeah, you can watch me play some Commander. I think I'm going to be playing my Eilie deck, which I have made a video on, so that could be fun. I'll probably bring a few other decks, and we'll see how many games we can get in. Well, if you would also like to send me a deck for me to work on, there is a link in the video description down below. You can send me a deck there. And if you'd like your deck to be the next one I work on, there's also a link in the video description as well. And as we get started, if you would like to take a look at Erica's deck yourself, I would say it's a very well-made Nahiri Forge and Fury deck. The link is in the description below. All right, so before we get to the deck, let's start talking about Nahiri, Forged in Fury, and why she is the lead of our equipment deck. Well, Nahiri, a longtime favorite character of mine, now only creature and not a planeswalker, has always been generally themed around either equipment or kind of madness, so here she's angry with equipment, so it's the perfect mix. She is a 6-mana core artificer in Boros colors, that's red and white. She's 5/4, and she has affinity for equipment, which means she costs 1 less for each equipment you control. That includes the commander tax. So if it's your second cast and you have at least 6 equipment, then you can for sure at least pay for the commander tax and only pay 2 mana to play her. Now, it is deceptive because it's not like she is 2 mana. You can't play her on the second turn, but it does generally reduce her mana so that you can do other things the turn she comes down. Then, her ability, which is the main reason you play her, is whenever an equipped creature you control attacks, exile the top card of your library. You can play that card this turn, and if it's an equipment spell, you may cast it without paying its mana cost, but it's only off the top of the deck, not any equipment spell. So she allows you to flip, basically draw cards off the top of your deck, and if they're equipment, they are free. This is very, very strong. She's very much so built to be a go-wide commander because the main power of her is how many times you can get that trigger to resolve. And if you can, like, at least attack with 3 equipped creatures the turn she comes out, that's probably going to be good enough to be 1, kind of a draw 3, and 2, any of those equipment coming in for free, you'll be pretty happy with the result. And with that in mind, that does mean we don't want to toss her out immediately. But looking at the deck itself, I am generally very impressed by it. And I will say I have quite a few suggestions for additions, but I wouldn't say the deck needs that much changing. There's a few things that I look at and I say, you know, we can change, and I don't find the most impressive. But by and large, the deck is very much so where it wants to be. It is a deck that is using as many Living Weapon and 4 Mirrodin cards it can get away with, and also as many Reconfigure cards as it can get away with, maybe to a detriment, but I do think the deck's heart is in the right place. I think we're at the point that the deck needs to kind of shave off or kind of find its groove of the power level it wants to play in. And if the goal is mid to high power, what we're going to need to do is be a little more, let's say, critical of certain cards that are in the decklist. And as Erica has said, a big noticeable thing is that this go wide creature deck has only 17 creatures, and the majority of the deck is artifacts. And if we were to maybe look through this quickly, looking at cards like Barb Battlefist, Batterbone, you know, cards that come in a Citizen's Crowbar, that come in with creatures and add them to the creature list, perhaps the list would be a little better. But even then, I am going to suggest we take out some of these, and I'm going to suggest alternative means of us creating more creatures for getting further, you know, getting a board state that way, as opposed to, you know, heavily leaning on Living Weapon for Mirrodin and Reconfigure. Because though these cards are really good because they do work as kind of multiple, they fit into multiple columns, they are generally weaker cards. And as we power up the deck, we're just going to hit that limit where we can no longer get away with those weaker cards. Quickly, we're going to take a look at the curve. The curve is really nice. 3 is the highest mana cost, and then we kind of fall off with a little spike at 5. At 6, the only cards are reduced themselves, Nahiri and Embercleave. And at 7, College or Complete, a card we'd like to cheat in if we can. And finally at 8, another card that is reduced in mana. So with the real curve kind of ending at 5, I am pretty happy with the deck's curve. 3 mana is a hard number to have as your highest number. I do tend to recommend it being 2, just because when you have two mana cards being your highest, you know, column, it means that on at 4 mana you can cast 2 of your most common spells. Whereas when it's 3, you have to wait till you have 6 mana. It's not great, but honestly, it's not the worst thing. So let's look at through the deck really quickly, see anything that sticks out to me as being a little clunky or not ideal. And starting in creatures, I have to right away take a look at our reconfigure creatures, right? As I've said before, Rabbit Battery is, in essence, a really good utility creature. The fact that it comes out as a 1-1 haste, the fact that you can attach it to a creature and give it +1/+1 in haste is not bad. However, as we approach this kind of limit of power, this ability gets worse and worse incredibly quickly. Think about in the way that in what situations can Rabbit Battery attack without equipment? And I'm going to suggest even with equipment. Rabbit Battery is just kind of there to trigger Nahiri's. I should have Rabbit Battery out. Sorry, I'm just thinking out loud. It's there to trigger Nahiri, and it's not really that great at it. You know, even if we play Rabbit Battery turn 1, you know, we reduce Nahiri's cost, we get an attack or two in, and then later we can equip it to Nahiri. Well, to one of our creatures, or Nahiri, honestly, because Nahiri is a 5/4 to start with. It's still kind of not ideal because we are losing a creature that we could equip onto, and at the same time, our anything that was equipped to Rabbit Battery does fall off. So I do think Reconfigure is the weaker of the Living Weapon and 4 Mirrodin, you know, text. So Rabbit Battery already, I'm not too impressed by. I could cut it. Lizard Blades, I am a little easier on because that the ceiling of Double Strike is really, really high. But even then, I don't really see it. I think if you get into a really good situation where Lizard Blades come out early, you can grab, you know, either the Beamstick, you can grab the Battleforge Bloodforge Battleaxe, cards like this that really benefit early game from getting multiple hits in, and attack one of your opponents that doesn't have a blocker yet, and you could get really far that way right at the start. However, this is not always going to be the case, any of your opponents who have any kind of interaction, well, Lizard Blades is incredibly fragile and is technically stopped by a lot of different kinds of blockers. Now, obviously, if you manage to get Beamtown Beatstick, which is, I think, the best case scenario onto it, so now it has Menace, you're going to be in a really great situation dealing 4 damage, getting 2 treasure tokens. But I will say I do find that to be rather magical Christmas land in a way. Maybe with more tutors, I would like it. But even then, are you really tutoring for this combo this early in the game? So I am going to say I'm not big on them. I'm not big on the blades, but I would understand if you kept them because I agree that the ceiling is rather high. Of the rest of the creatures, I tend to really like them. The two that stand out to me is Rayav just feels a little weak. You know, the idea, don't get me wrong, the idea of giving all of your creatures double strike is fine, but it is a little win more. Like, you need your creatures to be, in order your deck to do anything, your creatures need to be equipped and attacking. Then giving them double strike, I guess it is good and I'm fine with it, but it does seem weaker, right? It is reliant on you already succeeding in order to get ahead. Whereas we look at another dwarf such as Sram, who helps you succeed by whenever you cast an equipment, you're going to draw a card. Even if you don't have anything to equip it to, well, I guess you'll have Sram, but even if you don't have, you know, a bunch of creatures ready to attack, like, it doesn't matter, you're getting ahead. This is really good and neutral. Whereas Rayav here, I feel, just doesn't do that much in neutral. Maybe it makes a few of your smaller attacks a little more threatening, but I don't really know if I like it as much. So that's one I would cut, but I would understand if you want to keep it for the same. You know what? What I would do is suggest at least cutting either Lizard Blades or Rayav, and between them I would cut Rayav. And if not, I would cut both. Going down here, Danitha, Benalia's Hope. I like Danitha. I kind of like the smaller Danitha that reduces the cost of your equipment. The fact that she'll be able to come out earlier and attack earlier, because I honestly do think Danitha's greatest trait is the fact that she has First Strike, Vigilance, and Lifelink. Like, that is a very good grouping of abilities. And with that in mind, I think if I had the choice between them, I'd just take the smaller one. You know, you have a higher chance of casting the equipment in your hand by reducing the cost. Whereas Danitha comes out on turn 5, that's really late. And even then, you know, what are you cheating into play from your hand or your graveyard that, especially from your hand, you know, that you don't, you couldn't cast anyways, right? Remember, we talked about how the main part of the curve ends around 5. So Danitha already is the most expensive part of your deck. So what are we cheating into play? The fact that she pulls out of the graveyard, I think, is cute. But there's going to be times where this is just going to stick in your hand while you have nothing in your graveyard. This just doesn't feel like it keeps up to the power level of the rest of the deck, so I'd like to cut her. And if you'd want to switch her just straight for the smaller Danitha, I would probably do that, but I'm going to have other suggestions as well. Going into sorceries, I am most suspicious of Mana Geyser and Single Combat. Mana Geyser feels like a generically really good red card, but that kind of belongs in like Spellslinger or a deck with a much higher ability to draw cards, right? This is a spell you want to gain like 12 red mana from and then win that turn. And this deck just doesn't have the means to do that. Now, don't get me wrong, I feel like this is one of those cards that I'm going to suggest isn't ideal. And a lot of commentators and a lot of people that I've met also will have this feeling of like, yeah, but Cursed, you didn't see me on this one game where it gave me like, I don't know, 20 mana. And I'll admit, that's really good. But they aren't treasure tokens. They don't stick around. So you need a situation where you're going to cast Mana Geyser and be able to use that 20 mana. Now, with equipment, you can technically think of equipment as being a mana sink. So you can cast Mana Geyser and then use the mana to re-equip all your creatures when you don't have a free equipment ability. But that doesn't sound particularly fun now, does it? That sounds kind of lame. You don't want to spend your big Mana Geyser mana just re-equipping creatures. So you need to hold up Mana Geyser until you have a turn you can spend 20 mana, or like an absurd amount of mana. But then you have to remember you're also holding up Mana Geyser so it can create that much mana. And then you're starting to realize that you have a card that by itself does very little unless all of the stars align, and those two stars may not align at the right times, right? In addition, once again, it's 5 mana. It's one of the highest mana costs of your deck, and I don't particularly think it's where you want to be. This getting counterspelled is really, really bad for the deck. Looking at single combat, I also really don't like it. I do love thematically it being in here, but this is, it's just a bizarre card, right? It does neither thing, and it does two things, and neither of them it does well. One, it does one of those, everyone sacrifices abilities, everyone sacrifices down to one creature things, except for your opponents choose, unlike Tragic Arrogance, where you choose. So everyone keeps their best creature. So this is already bad, but one of the things is you're a go-wide deck, so sacrificing down to one is awful to you, even if the idea is that you can easily get your commander back, which we'll talk about in a second. It does leave you at a really disadvantageous position by getting rid of the wide in your go wide deck. So you're left with one creature, a bunch of equipment has fallen off your creatures, so you have to re-equip all of those creatures, so I hope you kept Piersteel Paladin. And that's no guarantee that you'll be able to attack through your opponent's creatures, because your opponents might have, Death Touch creatures, they might have Indestructible creatures, they might have Eldrazi creatures, that no matter how well you equip, you might not be able to get through. So that first part is particularly bad. But that second part that says players can't cast creatures or planeswalker spells is especially detrimental to you, because your commander needs to be out for you to regain the tempo of losing your board. And you don't really want to keep your commander out because she's so easy to recast, but you can't recast her because of single combat. And so you're stuck in this situation where your go-wide commander doesn't do anything. Yeah, the whole board isn't able to get a bunch of creatures out, but they already have the creature to block you. And yeah, I think the main idea of this is that you can play some Living Weapon creatures or 4 Meriden equipment to get creatures into play in a way that's unexpected. But even that's not great. Remember, this is till the end of your next turn. So you can't even, like, you could have 7 mana, play single combat, then play like a 4 Meriden card and feel clever. But then it comes to your next turn and you still can't play creatures, which you need for your deck to work. So all in all, I'm just incredibly unimpressed with this card. Outside of the flavor, I think this can be a number of different board clears, and I think the easiest one is just Blasphemous Act. Contrary to popular belief, even if you are a go-wide strategy, you want board clears that destroy all creatures, because board clears are safety valves. You play them when you're going to lose the game. And so the fact that they'll destroy all your creatures is okay. It's kind of a cost that you're making in order to stay in the game. And it's just not that bad because your equipment sticks around. So instead of having this kind of tricky, kind of functional board clear, let's just play a regular board clear. Blasphemous Act will be turned on by your deck most of the time, costing 1 mana. You'll be very, very happy. All right, looking at instants, I'm generally very, very happy. I have no problem here. Let's go back to artifacts in a second. Enchantments, I'm also generally happy, though forging the Tyrite Sword, if we are limiting the number of tutors, which I guess is a good time to talk about that, I would rather this be Fighter's Class, because Fighter's Class is just better, whereas this is ramp, and I do appreciate that. But your deck has a different relationship with ramp, because all of your equipment ramp you into your commander, who then ramps you into more equipment. So The treasure tokens are a little weaker here than they would be somewhere else. Also, forging the Tyrite Sword, I would argue, works really well with 4 or 5 mana commanders and not 6, because that treasure token you get at the start... I guess it does work with 6, because you get 2 treasure tokens by the time you untap, and 4+2. Yeah, okay, never mind. I take that back. There is some merit to the treasure token here, but even then, I think if you have the option, Fighter's class is much better. Speaking briefly about tutors, that's rough, buddy. I'm sorry, Erica, that you have to, you're limited to 3 tutors within your deck, because honestly, that's what makes white equipment and red-white equipment so strong, is the fact that you have access to tutors. It's like, you know, there's this long-standing idea that white does very poorly in Commander, and I don't think that's true at all anymore, but for a while it was like that. And some arguments that people made, which I do connect to, was that the white and red were really good at equipment, but the commander player base just didn't like equipment, which I do also agree with. And so it feels like we have the means of evening out the table to give white an advantage, and then white's legs have been cut from underneath them, so they can't even tutor for equipment. Like, this isn't vampiric tutor, this is, you know, forging the Tyrite Sword. But that's playgroup rules, that's how it is. I would hope one day you can build a version of the deck with as many tutors as you like, because that's kind of the fun of equipment. All right, let's look at artifacts, and let's go to additions. So some of these are gonna be easier than others. I think generally when it comes to us being critical, there's a few things that I think we should be cutting. Batterbone and Barbed Battlefist are both just fine cards. They are just 2 mana creatures that come with equipment, basically, right? Batterbone is a 1/1 Vigilance lifelink, which at least is fun to equip to, but has a terrible equip cost for the bone itself. And Barbed Batterfist is a 2/2 that becomes a 3/1 with a kind of weird equipment attached to it. Both of these cards are just not really good. Both the living weapon or Mirrodin side and the equipment itself. And though this works really well in lower powers of this deck, it just doesn't mesh here as much anymore and therefore kind of stands out. So I think those are probably going to go. We have both Lightning Greaves and Swiftfoot Boots. I think at a certain point you have to cut one of them, and it's generally Swiftfoot Boots, but it's worth considering that the Hexproof will allow you to keep equipping a creature, and your deck has the most means of getting around the equip cost. So Lightning Greaves can actually be the one that's going. These cards are really good until they're not, and you are rapidly approaching the point where they are not good. Something to just maybe help conceptualize this is that both Lightning Greaves and Swiftfoot Boots belong in decks where the main challenge is keeping one creature alive as opposed to keeping a board, because board clears do not care about Hexproof or Shroud. And though one might argue that that you are trying to keep a creature alive, and that's Nahiri, Nahiri's affinity allows her to be recast multiple times without much of a downside. So once again, we shouldn't be too worried about protecting her. She's going to die and come back, and that's going to be fine. So that leaves us with haste as the main reason to play these cards, and I don't think you need that much haste. I think one card is enough. You can tutor for either of these cards. I believe there's a few other cards that either, like Gold Warden's Gambit, that come in with haste, or a few other options I feel like I've seen. However, I guess Rabbit Battery is the one I was also going to ask for you to remove, so maybe there is a limit, but I just believe we're at the point that we're going to have to drop one of two. Bearded Axe as well feels cute. I don't mind it, but it's just at that kind of close to unplayable at this power level meter, right? It's like playing All That Glitters, which feels really, really good when you're ahead, and it's just equipment when you're behind. Of course, because it's an equipment deck, the floor is a little higher, but the fact that there's certain situations that this is just +1/+1, I would say is enough to cut it. Mithril coat as well, I'm not a big fan of. I've never been a fan of equipment that give indestructible. Like, Darksteel Plate is very similar to this as well. I will say, for what it's worth, the fact that this auto-attaches to something is nice. But once again, as I mentioned before, we're not too worried about losing Nahiri, so that shouldn't be a big problem. And even then, like, we do have some legendary creatures, but I feel like this is a 3-mana card that just doesn't do as much as we'd like. So this is suspicious to me, but doesn't need to be cut. That one's close. And then I think that's generally it. This one's a hard one for me, but I don't like Batterskull. This is a personal choice. I really think Batterskull for years was held up because it was the best creature you can pull with Stoneforge Mystic. And now that Cauldron Complete exists, Batterskull is just kind of a weird card. It is too expensive for a 4/4 Vigilance lifelink. It is also just kind of clunky to re-equip when you don't have means of, you know, equipping for free, which you do, which is nice. And then it has this weird, cute synergy where you can bounce it back to your hand. I wouldn't tell you to play a five mana 4/4. I wouldn't tell you 5-mana 5/5 Vigilance Lifelink. So why are we paying 5 for a 4/4 Vigilance Lifelink with a bunch of little tricks to it? I will agree that obviously in a equipment matters deck, this has a lot more synergy and fun things it can do. But personally, I've never been a fan of this card, and I would recommend cutting it, especially at this power level you're talking about. But the rest looks good. If there's something worth mentioning, I think, is that Sunforger could probably be doing a lot more, but that's dependent on you, on what kind of instance that you want to pull out. All right, let's go into some additions. And I'm going to have some general additions, but I'm going to say the main direction, I think, to solve your go-wide problems is that we want a little bit of token generation. Token generation is really easy and really strong in your colors and will very much so solve this creature problem. The thing is, your creatures are very, very fair. They show up, they interact with equipment, they do what they say on it, and they're very easy to destroy. Board clears are very effective on them. So we want to have ways to generate creatures that kind of get around board clears and kind of get around, have kind of bonus abilities that are more relevant for combat, so you don't have to think about them, you know, as cards you have to protect. And what I mean by that is, as I was saying before, Rabbit Battery's kind of main attraction is you can kind of throw it into battle with to get a Nahiri trigger, with the idea that it might die. But you can't do that with SRAM. You can't do that with, I guess you have to attack with Wyleth, so that's not a good... Arden, for example, because you want to keep... Or Piercesteel Paladin, because you want to keep these creatures alive, so you can't haphazardly throw them out there just to get another trigger when you know they might die. And tokens are a lot better at that. So, let's start from the top on theme, and I believe a really good addition is Nahiri the Lithomancer. She just got reprinted allegedly, well, not allegedly, she did, at Commander Masters, and according, allegedly, 40 cents. Pick her up. She does basically everything the deck wants, unsurprisingly, and namely that the fact that her tokens, she pumps out tokens that immediately get equipment on it, and then her minus does solve the problem that I mentioned a few times of cards being pulled out of your graveyard or hand. I think it's like Danitha I was talking about, and Nahiri the Lithomancer just does it better. So I think this is just a really easy inclusion. It solves a lot of problems, and you'll be really happy to have it. It is 5 mana, but I think it's fine. Kemba is another card that I think is rather good here. I think if you can even attach just one equipment on Kemba and leave her out like that, leave them out. I think Kemba's male. But you'll be happy creating a 2/2 white cat every turn. If you get multiple equipment, that's even better. All of a sudden you're creating an army every turn. But at the same time, like, this is fine, right? You're fine just having Kemba out, having attached one or two equipment or one equipment, and just generating some bodies. Not the best one. I wouldn't recommend this as much, but I do think a rather strong one. Let me find the other ones. Okay, close that. These are in a little random order here. This one I'm not sure about, but wedding announcement does attract. I do find it attractive because one, it triggers on end step, which I really like, and two, it does work as card draw later in the game. So wedding announcement will trigger three times, and each time you're going to either create a 1/1. Or if you attack with two or more creatures, you're going to draw a card. And I think you're going to be pretty happy with those 1/1s, right? Because they just represent another creature that you can attach an equipment with and just leave it. And of course, when wedding announcement transforms to wedding festivity, creatures getting +1/+1 is just kind of nice in your go wide deck to make a bit of a difference. So I think this is fine. Is it great? I can't believe it's this expensive, though. It's $10. Maybe I'm less keen on that, unless you can budget it into it. $10 feels a lot for this ability, but I do think it is a strong thing to do. A much cheaper version of this ability is Goblin Assault. Goblin Assault says it's on upkeep, you create a 1/1 goblin, but it gains haste immediately, which I do particularly like. And something I do like about it is it does say goblins attack each turn if able, but you don't mind because you want to equip those goblins and attack right away, especially if you can get Nahiri out and start getting those triggers back. I like this. I think this is fine. Once again, it's not the strongest one, but it is a play it and forget it kind of token generator, so I'm a big fan of that. Something that's a kind of in between all of these that I do really like is Outlaw's Merriment. I've talked about this card before because I do really think this is a strong card. Outlaw's Merriment gives you one of the three, Robin Hood's, allies, and they always have haste, which is really, really good. And then they have a secondary ability, which is rather good. So Trample is a really good one that we're really happy to get. And Lifelink is also pretty good. And the rogue is the weakest because unfortunately dealing one damage to anything isn't as ideal, but a ping here and there never hurts. The ability to take down certain targets is, Dark Confidants, Thalia's is really, really good. And then you're just happy to have a hasty creature. I would say Outlaw's Merriment is by far the strongest, but it is an additional mana. It is 4 mana, but you'll be really, really happy of the constant stream of tokens you'll be getting to put equipment onto. The main goal is that in between turns, you don't have to worry, or after a board clear, you don't have to worry, you're back in the game. Two more, which were the first ones I found, which is why they're at the end of the list for some reason, which I think are rather strong. Let's see. Adeline is really interesting to me because she creates 3 humans every time you attack. The thing is, those humans are likely to die, and it's really hard to get equipment onto them outside of Sigarda's Aid and Forge Anew, and even then you won't get the attack trigger. But I think there might be something there. I'm just leaving Adeline out there just as an idea because I think there's probably a way to make it work, but it might not be worth it. She does represent a very large amount of aggression because she basically creates 3 attackers each turn. And I think that's really, really strong, especially with other means of pumping your attackers. But I leave that to you to decide in the end of the power of that. But the main one that I want to suggest that obviously I've left for last is Skrillov's Hive. Skrillov's Hive is a weird creature, or a weird card, because it was one of those cards that people thought was going to be really, really good, and it's not really, really good, right? But the thing is, here, I really like it. The life loss is minimal. You have access to a lot of lifelink in your deck. You don't really care about the fact they can't block, because they're just going to be creatures you're going to attack with equipment. And I think the fact that they have toxic is going to make them arbitrarily attractive to kill. Magic players are really, really scared of poison counters, just abnormally so, right? And for what it's worth, a 1/1 toxic creature attacks as if it has 4 power if you imagine it doing 10% per hit, which is pretty impressive. But the thing is what you can do outside any other of these token producers I've named is that you can start... What you can do is you can start using these creatures as like fodder that you just attack with, and your opponents will go out of their way to destroy them. Now, what's weird about this feels kind of antithetical to what you want to do. It costs mana to re-equip every time, so ideally you want those creatures to stay equipped. But the thing is, you do want your opponents to burn their blockers and to burn their removal on things that aren't your key creatures. And Skrull's Hive literally gives you an unending, you know, torrent of these kind of creatures. I will say, of all of them, because of the lack of haste, Skrull's Hive is the worst to play later in the game. In fact, if you have this later in the game, if you can get rid of it, it's probably better. If you can discard and draw it, you're probably happier. But in the meantime, I think if you can play in this in the first 4 turns, I think it's a card that you'll be very, very happy with. Just the kind of soft power and distraction it will give to you on the table, I think will absolutely be worthwhile. All right, I have a few more suggestions in terms of cards for the deck. One I always think of in equipment decks with red is Togo. We're not in a situation that Togo, that you want the number of equipment to be really high. You want number of creatures. But let's think about the fact that Togo's equipment generation, just like everything else, it's token generation, and you're going to be just really, really happy to have it around. In fact, there's probably a lot of situations where Togo's rock tokens are just better just on the battlefield laying there, right? I think you will be pretty happy with that result. Oops. And I wonder... Combat damage. Okay, you can't make toxic. It's not like Infect where you can throw rocks and all of a sudden they're poison rocks. Too bad. But in the meantime, I think Togo and Piercedale Paladin are immensely good together, right? Every time you play a land, you draw a card. Cards like Arden and... Let me see. What's... Thought there was another one that we can use. I guess it's also Piercedale Paladin. Allows us to attach a bunch of rocks all over the place to one creature so that something can get a big boost from the number of equipment it has. Or you can spread them around really easily to make sure all of your tokens or all of your creatures have one equipment, even though it's just a rock that you're not going to use. I still think Togo is a really easy addition. Let's go to another one. Glimmer Lens. I feel like Glimmer Lens is notably absent here. It is a creature, you know, it is a 4 Mirrodin card. You get a 2/2 for 2, which is really nice. And this says whenever this and another creature attacks, draw a card. Really nice, really straightforward. I think you're really happy to have this piece of equipment. And it's much better than like the ones that just give you a small power or toughness boost. This is just happier. Let's see. I don't know how I feel about this, but while I was looking around, I did find Clever Concealment, which is a little pricey, but seems to be a really good, you know, 4 mana with Convoke, phase out any number of permanents. And considering your deck is so vulnerable to like mass artifact hate, Clever Concealment feels like a really good answer to that. You can also get it from Sunforger, which I think is good, but generally you'll just be really happy that if someone casts a Planar Cleansing or something like that, you can phase out every single one of your equipments, the tokens included, and be happy with the results. Finally, another card that just caught my eye, and I don't know if it's good, is Arterial Alchemy. This is a weird one because I didn't know this existed until I started looking. And so this says, it's a red enchantment that says for 3 mana, enters the battlefield, get a blood token for each opponent you have, which is 3. And then blood tokens you control are equipment in addition to their other types. They give +2/+0 and 2 to equip. So here's the thing. I know this is built for like a blood token matters deck. But what this card reads to me is 3 mana, create 3 equipment that in addition to being equipment are blood tokens. I don't think it's worth, you should underestimate how good a blood token is. Blood tokens are really, really good because they help fix your hand, especially later in the game where you need to draw something to stay in the game, right? And the fact that this combos with a number of parts of your deck, like three mana for three equipment, is a fantastic deal. And you're really, really happy to get that deal and slowly equip them to your cards over time, or Pierce Your Paladin, obviously, or I just keep saying his name and I keep forgetting it. Our boy Arden, you know, attach six additional power to a creature all at once and attack with it is really, really nice. The other thing that's really worthwhile to note is that even when they are equipment, you can still sacrifice them as blood tokens. Like, even when they're equipped to a creature, right? So that, you know, if someone goes to wipe all your equipment or all the tokens or anything like that, and you have extra mana, you can just use the blood tokens to at least get a little more value out of them if you can't then stop them from being destroyed, which I think is really, really cool. I think Arterial Alchemy is a really cool card that works really well as a kind of middle piece. Like, the power of blood tokens and the power of getting three equipment is rather good. All right, the last thing I want to kind of end on is a conversation about power level. And what I wanted to talk on is that if you are finding that you are getting to the point that your deck is having a hard time competing in a slightly higher power pod, well, the next step is going to be to just add creatures, especially in white, that are just really powerful in Commander, right? It's not as fun, it's not on theme, but they can hold equipment and you're going to be pretty happy with the results. Easy inclusions are things like Mother of Runes and Giver of Runes, both of which are really good protection throughout the entire game and can be a really, you know, protect from single target removal, protect from blocks, just a very, very strong card. Then, always pricey and desperate for a reprint, Dranith Magistrate should definitely be in here. You can very easily equip them. I don't know how often you attack with them, but Dranith Magistrate is hated for a reason. It shuts down your opponent's ability to do the one thing you come to Commander to play, and that's really, really powerful. You'll be really happy with the results. Likewise, Aven Mind Sensor is almost universally a really, really good card. The fact that it flies gives you another bonus to equip it to make sure you can get hits in with like the Beamtown Beatstick and stuff like that. But, you know, you said each player can only have, or at least for your deck, and I'm assuming this is going to go to your opponents as well, that there is a limit on numbers of tutors. Well, fetch lands weren't on that list. You didn't say land tutors, which is one of the things that really frustrates me. Anyone who believes that land tutors are somehow less strong than real tutors, like even things like Cultivate and Kodama's Reach, I feel like you're doing something wrong. If you don't tell green it can't play a million tutors, and even if those tutors just get basics, like, green is going to be a very powerful color. Everyone has access to tutors for a reason. Anyways, back to on point, Aven Mind Sensor will shut down land tutors, will shut down each of their tutors to by a very wide margin, and is just a fantastic creature to attack with. Likewise, when we're talking about searching, Archivist of Ogma is a rather good card. You just flash them out when you can, and then whenever they search their library, you'll draw a card. This one, a little more than Aven Mind Sensor, would depend on how many land tutors exist in your pod. If people are playing fetch lands, very good. If they're not, probably not as good. Then, speaking of searching your library, I didn't realize that this might not be allowed, but I wrote it down here anyway. So Ranger Captain of Eos is an incredibly strong card because it will tutor Esper Sentinel. I guess that is not allowed because of your limits, so unfortunate you can't use him, but a very good creature for other people who are looking to power up a deck like this. Finally, Thalia Heretic Cathar is really, really strong. We can't play Little Thalia because too much of our deck is non-creature, but Big Thalia is pretty happy in a game like this because it keeps your opponent's blockers tapped so that you can get more hits in, and non-basic lands your opponents control entering the battlefield tapped is really strong once you start getting past, you know, a power level of like 7 or 8 or what have you, right? When people have fetch lands, when people are looking for specific, like have very few basics in their decks, Thalia is a very, very big hindrance to their plan. So those are generally my points. Let's do a nice little conclusion wrap up. Oh, this video's gone on for a while, but in a good way. I've been very happy with this deck and I've been happy to work on it. My thought is, in conclusion, the main cards that you're going to need to start pulling out are the cards that are just not keeping up to power level, that work on theme but don't represent a lot by themselves. Some things like our Reconfigure cards, some of our Living Weapon cards, some of our Formeridan cards are pretty easy to cut. Mana Geyser and Seal Combat, I believe they just belong in different decks, so I wouldn't play either of them. Danitha also feels a bit too much mana for what she does for the deck, and I don't like Batterskull. Then, for cards to put in, I think you should absolutely put in Nahiri. I think you should absolutely put in Skrelop's Hive, and then think about Togo. Absolutely put in Glimmer Lens. And then probably I think you'd be happy with some combination of some token generation to keep having bodies to attach your cards to. Arterial Alchemy I think is really strong. I would really like if you could test it out because I have a really good feeling about this card in a deck like this, and I'd love to hear, you know, if it does well. So I have a vested interest of you trying that out. And then finally, if you're still feeling like you're behind in power, look into what we would call generically strong white cards, white creature cards. You can go red as well, but I personally would start with the white ones because they are much more powerful. And also, I don't want to have to suggest, the goblin? Can never remember what Dockside Extortionist. Yeah, I never want to suggest Dockside Extortionist. It's not a card I like, and it's a lot of money, so I'd rather start by suggesting like Dranith Magistrate, Mom, Stepmom, and all that. All right, I hope this Decasys video was helpful to you. I really like Nahiri, I really like how the deck is going, and I would love to see another draft of the deck. If you could, if you're interested in sending me another draft, you can send it to me using the link you can find in the video description down below, or any deck you want to send. And if you'd like to, you know, bring your deck list to the next video I'll make, there's a link for that as well. Finally, if you'd like to like, comment, subscribe, I'd be very, very happy. We just made 300 subscribers. That's really exciting to me, and I can't wait for, you know, the channel to grow even further. Thank you so much, Erica, for the deck, and good luck making it better.